Though the Creality K1 series, the K1, K1C and K1 Max are running with Klipper-based Creality OS, the advanced features and capabilities of the real Klipper firmware are hidden. The limited web interface is sufficient for running and monitoring 3D print jobs, making the 3D printers very beginner-friendly. A lot of interesting features, like meshing, PID tuning, baby stepping, are only available through the touch display, and adding a second webcam isn't possible. If you want even more control or add extensions to your K1, then there's no other way than to break that chain. However, though Creality has released their Klipper firmware on GitHub and thereby followed the license under which Klipper is licensed, it doesn't automatically give you the real Klipper experience. Out of the box, all K1s are operated by Creality OS. The web interface provides just the bare minimum to operate the printer. Besides uploading and starting files to print, it allows for moving and homing the axis, setting the temperatures of the bed and nozzle, and to control the fans and light. They have placed a few small obstacles in the way, presumably to prevent inexperienced users from rendering their 3D printers unusable. If that doesn't put you off, I'll show you how to get full access and control to your K1's Klipper to use the improved input shaper calibration, advanced meshing and purging, better time-lapse control, and how to add a USB webcam in addition to the Creality AI cam and more. A nice guy from France named Giu, I hope I pronounced it correctly, has dug into this and made his findings available in a wiki. As usual, I put the link in the description. Before you get your hands dirty, let's go through the procedure together. So, let's unleash the beast. First, make sure that you have the latest firmware. You can check it in the system menu. If it's below 1.3.2.20, you have to update it to a later one. It will add a new root account information entry to the system menu. To unlock root access, touch the gear icon to enter the settings menu. Then select root account information. The text on the screen describes the consequences and dangers of activating root, like being able to delete required system files, which of course could turn your 3D printer into a decorative brick. No need to worry. If you follow the steps, the risk is minimal. In case something goes wrong, you can easily revert. Below the text is a deactivated button with a 30-second countdown, after which it gets active. Confirm the dialog, touch it, and now root access is enabled. The dialog shows the account information for the root user. Take note of the password for the next step. To install the helper script, you have to establish a connection to the printer's shell first. Open an SSH connection to the printer's shell using a command line on Windows 11 or tools like PuTTY, WinSCP, or Mobileraker. Type SSH root add followed by the IP address of your K1. You can look it up on the touch screen. After pressing enter, provide the password of the root account. In my case, it's Creality_2023 and press enter again. Then open the wiki for Creality K1 series from the link in the description. It contains a detailed description of each step required and I use it as a reference here. Click helper script installation in the menu on the left, copy the git clone command, paste it into the shell and execute it. It downloads and puts the script in the user data helper script folder. Run the helper script by executing the next command in the wiki. It will show a nice menu that looks very similar to the Kiawa script. The script bundles all the tools and commands required for the personal configuration of your Klipper installation without you having to enter cumbersome command sequences on the command line. It also takes care of downloading missing installation packages and informs you if another feature needs to be installed first for a certain feature. Choose one to enter the installation submenu. Then install Moonraker and Nginx from the essentials. Next, install Mainsail or Fluid if you prefer that. You can install both, but I recommend choosing only one. Both provide a similar experience. Therefore, it's mostly a choice of taste. Though, when you own the newer revision of the AI cam and want to create time-lapses, you should go with Fluid, because Mainsail doesn't allow you to select the cam in the time-lapse settings. Once the installation is complete, you will be able to use the new user interface. Enter the IP address, followed by a colon and the port number 4409 for Mainsail in your web browser's address line. When using Fluid, use 4408 as port number. The new UI already provides a wide range of options and controls that are more advanced than what is available in the Creality UI. For instance, you can adjust the brightness of the LED lights instead of simply turning it on or off. Furthermore, you can view system load information, access a G-code editor and preview, and use a G-code command line, among other features. To activate the AI cam, click the settings icon, scroll down and click webcam. Click add and give your webcam a name and close the settings. That's all you need to get the camera feed showing up. Later, I will explain how to add a second webcam that can be connected to the front USB port. Next, you should install Entware and the Klipper G-code shell command utilities. They are needed to install some of the improvements in the next step. To edit files conveniently in the shell, I can now install my favorite editor, Nano, using the command opkg install nano. It's easier to use than vi. From the list of improvements, I recommend Klipper adaptive meshing and purging, as well known as CAMP, the improved shaper calibration, and useful macros. For the security conscious among us, GitHub Backup ensures that our painstakingly crafted configuration files aren't lost if disaster strikes. In the camera section, Moonraker Timelapse and camera settings control are cool. But before, I want to say thanks to my sponsor, which is PCBWay. Do your electronic projects still look like this? Or a little more major like this? Getting professional-looking DIY projects like this one has never been easier utilizing the services of PCBWay.
PCBWay offers high-quality PCBs starting as low as $5 for 5 PCBs. Using KiCad with the PCBWay plugin, it is the easiest to get an instant quote. One click prepares and uploads the Gerber files to PCBWay, where you then can adjust and change the available options to your needs, add a stencil, choose their assembly service, and more. Then complete the order to get your professional PCBs within a few business days. Besides that, PCBWay also offers high-quality CNC machining, 3D printing services, sheet metal fabrication and more, which makes PCBWay your one-stop shop, no matter if you're a hobbyist or an established company.
Klipper Adaptive Meshing and Purging, or short CAMP, improves building a bed mesh for a print job by only meshing the area of the print. That way, the resulting mesh is denser and more precise. It also uses adaptive purging next to the print. Before installing it, you have to install the virtual pin support. It's a requirement before you can install CAMP. Then install CAMP and allow it to update the configuration files. CAMP relies on object labeling, which is also needed for the exclude objects feature. Right now, this feature works in Prusa Slicer and its versions Bamboo Studio and Orca Slicer. Ultimaker Cura doesn't support it yet. In Prusa Slicer, go to the printer settings, general, and set the G-code flavor to Klipper. In the output options of the print settings, select firmware specific from the drop-down. When you slice, upload and print a G-code file now, you'll see that the meshing and purging only takes place in the area where the object is. You can take a look at the mesh in the height map on mainsail or tune menu in Fluid. If necessary, you can use a button in the UI to disable the feature as well as the creation of a mesh. The stock input shaper calibration only runs the calibration for the x-axis. The same shaper parameters are then used on the y-axis as well. That's not optimal, obviously. The improved shaper calibrations fix that. After you install the feature and run the calibration, it'll first test the y-axis for vibrations. Next, it calibrates the x-axis. It then figures out the best settings to reduce them, finding and setting the right adjustments for that too. For the security conscious among us, Git-Backup ensures that our painstakingly crafted configuration files aren't lost if disaster strikes. It automatically takes care to backup a copy of your invaluable configuration files on GitHub. Unfortunately, it did not work out of the box. It didn't create backups, so I checked the code and shared my fixes with Geo. When you watch the video, your installer will likely be updated. To set it up, you first have to create a repository in your GitHub account for the backup files. Click on Create Repository, name it, and decide whether to make your configs private or public. Leave the other options as shown. To allow the backup feature access to the new repo, create a personal access token. go to https://github.com/settings/tokens, click generate new token and give it a name that helps you remember its use later on. Then set the expiration date. The fine-grained token is only valid for up to 1 year from its creation and must be renewed if it expires. The fine-grained one can be limited to a specific repository rather than being valid across your entire Git account. For the repository permissions, set administration and metadata to read-only and give read-write access to contents and workflow. Click on Generate Token to create the token. Leave the window with the token open because this is the only time you will see it. We are now ready to install Git-Backup. The installation script will prompt you to enter your GitHub username, the name of the repository, the branch name to store the backups, and the token that you just created. Simply copy and paste the token into the shell when prompted. The installation finishes by creating an initial backup of your configuration files and keeps them up to date whenever a change is made. Moonraker's timelapse feature gives you much more control over the creation of timelapses than the built-in one. After installation, you have to add a small snippet timelapse take frame to your slicers before layer change GCode to trigger taking a picture for the timelapse as shown for Prusa slicer here. Then, in the main cell UI, enable timelapse and configure it. If you want a second camera to have another perspective for monitoring the 3D printer or to create better timelapses, then this is for you. A script by user Travel3D enables the use of USB cameras on the front port. Copy the first command from the description in his repository. It clones the repo and runs the install script. For installation, you can choose between a single USB camera or both USB and K1 AI camera by selecting the second option. Sadly, the camera selection for timelapse is not working in mainsail. However, it works without any problems in Fluid. If you want to use the second cam for timelapses, you may want to switch to Fluid. Last but not least, let's enable remote control and monitoring of the printer from your smartphone. There are several options available, from which I show using Mobileraker. Install it as usual, then install the Mobileraker companion app from your smartphone's App Store. On the first launch, you have to add your 3D printer, provide a name and the IP address and the port number 7125. Verify it by testing the connection and continue. That's all. The dashboard shows the status of your 3D printer and allows you to monitor and control some settings remotely. I'm sure you are ready to explore more features. Using the script is low risk and installing and uninstalling features is easy. If you have any issues, the community can provide helpful solutions. Which are your favorite features? Leave it in the comments. Thank you for watching, everyone. I hope you enjoyed the video. If so, please don't forget to subscribe and activate the bell. Also, check out my other videos. Happy 3D printing, and I look forward to seeing you next time here on 3D Printing Geek.